911, what's the address of your emergency?
911 operators are the lifeline between victims and police. It's a critical job. That's why city officials are alarmed by recent Facebook postings obtained by News 8. We received these screenshots from a source. They're from the Facebook page of Dallas 911 operator April Sims. Here is one post from her page. Black people are outrageous. They are more like animals. They never know how to act, always causing problems. I can count on one hand the black people I know who don't have expletive for brains. Sims was hired back in December when Dallas police were trying to quickly hire 911 operators after delays in responding to critical cases like Deanna Cook. Her murder was captured on a 911 call through a series of mistakes, though her body wasn't found until 2 days after her call for help.
A new study out of the New England Journal of Medicine has released an alarming study. It found that black and Hispanic individuals are less likely to receive CPR from bystanders than white individuals. The study's senior author is Dr. Paul Chan, who's also a cardiologist at St. Luke's Mid-America Heart Institute right here in Kansas City, and he joins us now. Dr. Chan, welcome back to Up to Date. Always good to have you here.
Thank you so much for having me, Steve.
What prompted you to undertake this study?
We were struck by the fact that there are 1,000 cardiac arrests outside the hospital annually in the United States. So there's a huge disease burden. And what's particularly important is that when people have a cardiac arrest, the heart stops and it's an emergency that requires bystanders to respond. And if they get bystander CPR from any individual, their likelihood of surviving to discharge from a hospital is twice as those who don't get bystander CPR.
So it's a big deal.
It's a huge deal.
You looked at this issue for when folks are at home and also when they're out in public, doctor. Was there a difference?
There was. You know, what we were particularly interested in was whether, if you're black or Hispanic, your likelihood of getting life-saving CPR from anyone, a family member at home or a bystander stranger in public, was lower than if you're white. And we hypothesized that if you were black or Hispanic, you would be less likely to get bystander CPR at home, because we already know from our prior work that training rates for CPR are lower in black and Hispanic communities. However, what we were interested in understanding in public settings, like the gyms, the airports, on the streets, if you get a cardiac arrest and you're black or Hispanic, we hypothesized that that disparity would be smaller because there would be other people around. If you're black or Hispanic and you have your arrest at home, you're 26% less likely to get CPR from a family or loved one or friends. That's what we expected, around that range. In public, that difference is 37% lower for black and Hispanic individuals. It's even larger than when we have individuals have cardiac arrest at home.
That's absolutely crushing.
And as things unfold, it's like he wasn't breathing. And I figured this is not a normal seizure that I've ever seen. It's something's bigger than this. And it's no need to waste any time. You know, let's get it done. Let's call 911.
Mitchell County Emergency.
Yes, I have an ambulance coming. 1102 Washington Hall. It's a nurse who was run by us. And he just went to Boston and he needs some assistance.
What are you talking about?
Huh?
What are you talking about?
I'm talking about someone needs, run by us needs help.
Well, it doesn't matter what his name is. What's the problem?
He's not breathing right.
What's your name?
My name is Brian.
Brian what?
True.
Lynn Bias. Lynn Bias. It is not Turkey Day this week. The cows, context of white supremacy. The hashtag, I said it, I've been using it. It's not Turkey Day, it's the cows week. Every day this week we are broadcasting. Racism, white supremacy does not take vacations. So we do not take vacations either. Certainly not this week. Every day, no confusion. 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific, except one day. It is a global system, so there is one day this week. They are certainly not doing Turkey Day in other parts of the world. So we will have a guest on Wednesday who is not in the U.S., so that one will have to be an early program, time difference and all. We'll get details on that later, but exception of Wednesday, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific, every day this week. Lynn Bias. Anywho, our program for today, wow, we've talked for many years, folks have said, you know, health should be its own specific area of people activity. It's super important. That is one area we have not neglected in our studies over 13 plus years of counter-racist broadcasting. I posted the broadcast that we did with Dr. Alondra Nelson 10 years ago, her book, Body and Soul, where she details the history of the Black Panther Party and specifically the medical history, exactly what we're talking about today. Black people said, man, racists, they don't serve black people. We can't go to the doctor. We can't get ambulances. We will do that. And they went to providing tremendous services, and some of the same things happened that we'll talk about in this book, but her book, Body and Soul, Alondra Nelson, guest on the program, Ron Lax, talked about his grandmother, Henrietta Lax. In fact, we read Rebecca Skloot, Suspected Racist. We read her book in the book club, and then we had Ron Lax as a guest on the program to talk about his book. Very close, Baltimore, Johns Hopkins, Medical Apartheid, Harriet A. Washington. Read many of her books, Medical Apartheid, one of the most important books that I have read in my life. So glad that we got to cover it for the program today. All of that context for what we are going to discuss. Now, specifically the audio segments that we heard the 911 report. I could have picked a bevy of those. We heard one down in Dallas, Texas, where 911 white female dispatcher, all of her social media posts about black people, manure for brains, sanitized that a little bit for you all, right? I could have picked a bunch of those calls. I could have even went more current, or I could have went more famous, because I could have picked 2014 when it was Dr. Maya Angelou, Forsyth County, North Carolina. She passed away, unfortunately. They called 911. She's not breathing. Cardiac arrest. I've heard that so many times with black people. Eric Garner and all that. Can't breathe. I can't breathe. And they call 911. This is Dr. Maya Angelou. They call 911. And it's not, oh my goodness, Dr. Maya Angelou. I read, I know why the caged birds sing. Nah. It was, what? Dr. Angelou. Ugh. She's buddies with that no good Oprah Winfrey, and they're all woke and racism this and rarent. This is recorded on the 911. As Dr. Angelou, her life literally slipping out of her body, and that's what's on the recording. Or I could have went real recent and went this year. Remember the Buffalo Tops shooting? I know everybody forgot about that. Old news. Shootings every day. But May, when they had that shooting, one component of that shooting was that a black person from Tops called 911. Hey, we got a racist terrorist shooting up the place, killing people. We need help. And the 911 dispatch, whoop, this is some kind of crank call. Get out of here. Making up, blaming white people. Hung up the phone. I know that's old news. We got the snowstorm now and everything, bringing up old stuff. I know. So I could have picked a bevy. I just picked one. I went current. I went with the report that we just heard this weekend about CPR and black people being less likely to get CPR. And then they went through the many reasons why that is in cardiac. I can't breathe. I can't breathe. Eh. What's my line? Pulp Fiction. Nobody who will be missed. And then we ended. I've been talking about Lynn Bias all this time, and in the book that we read today, it starts right at Baltimore, Maryland. I said, oh my goodness. And the subject matter, even that, to hear that 911 call, for people who don't know, Lynn Bias drafted second in the NBA 1986 draft by the Boston Celtics. going to play with Larry Bird, dies. You've been a star at the University of Maryland, played against the great Michael Jordan when he was at USC, dies. Drug overdose. You heard the 911 call right there, which was even interesting, because like, this is Lynn Bias. We need help. It doesn't matter who he is. What are you talking about? Like, dang. Woo. Long sordid history with non-white people, black people specifically, and the paramedics, and so much of it I didn't even know. That is the whole point of the book we are chatting about today. Our guest on the program, a journalist and a former paramedic himself. Isn't that wacky? At least knowing that, I got a much better grasper. Oh, okay, that's how he would. Got it. Okay, journalist, former paramedic. In fact, he was a paramedic in my old stomping grounds, the mean streets of Atlanta, Georgia. He put this here book together, American Sirens, the incredible story of the black men who became America's first paramedics. Whew, incredible story. And wow, like people that go to med school, like you should know all about these people, Freedom House and John Moon. Eh. Totally. So many layers of racism after you get through all of the terrorism that's in this book. At the end, the eraser, like it never even happened. A pleasure to kick off our week here. It's not Turkey Day. It's the Cow's Week. Starting things off, our guest joining us live, the author of the great book we're chatting about this evening, Mr. Kevin Hazzard. Almost said Howard. Where did I get Howard from? Kevin Hazzard. Thank you so much for sharing a bit of your time. Mr. Hazzard, are you with us, sir?
Yeah, thanks for having me.
Bravo. Thank you for sharing a bit of your Monday evening with our listeners. For folks who, I'm sure this might be for some folks their first time hearing from you, any brief info you'd like to tell them about who you are and the work that you do?
Yeah. You know, like you said, I'm a journalist, but also a former paramedic. I was working at a newspaper around 9/11, and just kind of like a lot of people, I think, felt like I needed to be part of something bigger. You know, the world was shifting around me. And where that led me was onto an ambulance, oddly enough. Spent a decade working for Grady here in Atlanta. If you're from Atlanta, you definitely know Grady. And did that for 10 years and then got back into writing, which is, you know, what led me to the story here.
Yes, I've exchanged many jokes about Grady Hospital in Atlanta. We talked about that program here a few times. ATL, right on. For listeners who this might be their first time hearing from you, you are a white man. Is that correct?
Yes, I am.
Are you still in Atlanta, Georgia?
Just returning. We lived in that's not where I'm from. We moved around a bunch. We were gone for about 7 or 8 years, and we just came back in the last year or so.
Okay. Let's see. Before we hop into the book, ask all of our guests, use the term racism and the term white supremacy as synonyms. I use the same definition for both terms. The definition I use is as follows: a global system of people who classify themselves as white and are dedicated to abusing and or subjugating everyone in the known universe whom they classify as not white. Do you think such a system exists? Do you think that definition is accurate?
Certainly an accurate description. You know, we're kind of, my wife and I are in the midst of watching the Ken Burns Holocaust in America, so it's kind of, it'd be awfully difficult to, refute it. You look at all the history we've had, there's definitely people out there who believe that they should be on top.
Okay. Just for our conversation, this is something I do when I talk to really, especially white people about racism. I try to make sure that they answer my question, because I found sometimes that is a major problem. So do you think such a system exists? Do you think that definition is accurate? I can give you the definition again if you need it for racism, white supremacy.
Yeah, again, I think the definition is accurate, and Yeah, it would be difficult to look at history and disagree with it.
Grand. Let's see. Also, I have learned a lot from asking our white guests over the years. There's a report. It was written by a non-white author. It came out in 2014, same year Dr. Maya Angelou passed away, where he wrote that white people are often sincerely and greatly pained by racism, but rarely are they pained enough. I've been asking our white guests the first portion of that sentence. White people are often greatly and sincerely pained by racism. Do you think just you're a white person, you've been around white people, study white people, writing books about racism, do you think that a substantial number of individuals classified as white are often sincerely and greatly pained by racism?
Man, I don't know that is it's really difficult to speak for a very large group of people, but I will say that I think a lot of people have spent a lot of their lives acting as if anything that happened in the past no longer happens today. And so therefore what we have today is a world in which that sort of thing does not exist. So I don't know. I think a lot of people are in a lot of denial. Does that mean that they're very pained by it and that they're, you know, in some way sort of stricken by its existence and that's why the denial is there? Or does the denial keep them from feeling that way? It would be, I don't know if I can delve into somebody's psychology, but I think a lot of people are certainly in denial that that exists. So I'm not sure whether that's true or not.
Just pointing this out for our victims of racism who are listening in, I did not, nor do I ever ask our white guests or anyone in that matter to speak for all white people or speak for a group. My question specifically was just your opinion. Do you think that a substantial number of individuals classified as white are greatly pained? That's not speaking for them. That's just an observation. People do that regularly. The second component, I'll be more specific. Freedom House, that's what we're going to get to. The white people in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania specifically, in the book that we're talking about, that you wrote about this time frame, 1960s, 1970s, were they often sincerely and greatly pained about what happened to Freedom House and or black people at large in Pittsburgh?
Boy, it would be hard to say at the time that they were. The way that people were treated in that city, you know, there are a lot of examples of, you know, whether it was people protesting hiring practices at Iron City Brewery, people protesting hiring practices at Decane Light, people protesting hiring practice at union construction jobs. They were treated pretty poorly. I mean, there are stories of construction workers, multiple stories up, dropping bags full of water on black protesters in the street. It would be difficult to say that a man dropping a bag of water onto a protester in the street is pained by the existence of racism. You know, obviously not everybody in the city felt that way, but I mean, evidence would suggest that there were an awful lot of people in that city who were perhaps more a part of the problem than they were wringing their hands over its existence.
Interesting metaphor, wringing their hands. If I could make one request, one of the ways that I found that white people often deliberately practice racism, white supremacy, is by obfuscating, where they will not answer things directly. They will pussyfoot. Even it's been a couple times, as opposed to no, white people were not greatly pained. You said it would be difficult to say yes. That is substantially different than saying, and we had the uncomfortable laughter too for listeners, but that is substantially different than just saying, no, there was no evidence that people classified as white were greatly pained. Do you see the difference there?
Yeah, I do, but I wasn't alive in Pittsburgh in the 60s and 70s. I can tell you what I've read, and what I've read is that a lot of people were certainly not pained. That is definitely not the case with everybody, but certainly a lot of the people were not pained.
Right on. Before we get to American Sirens, specifically John Moon, Freedom House, some of these other folks, that report, Dr. Paul Chan, cardiologist, his report about black people, non-white people, being less likely to get CPR, and it gets even worse when you are out in public, and it doesn't matter if you're in an environment with white people or non-white people, black people are way substantially less likely to get CPR. I don't know if you saw that or not. That was super recent. That was just within the last couple of days, that audio report. But what do you think about that? If you've heard that, that's certainly pretty close to your former field.
I have not heard that, but I don't know that I'm entirely surprised. I think we are, a lot of us are aware that there are some pretty strong racial feelings that exist in this country, and so the idea that two people fall down, same place, different days, responded to or surrounded by the same people. One is a minority. One is a white guy. The white guy gets different treatment. I don't know that a lot of people would necessarily be surprised by that. I mean, I think that's sort of the predicament that we find ourselves in, and which I think a lot of people are trying to raise their voices against.
White guy, white girl, white child, apparently all of the above would do substantially better than someone classified as black in cardiac, or which that is another reason, I guess, maybe one, go get CPR training. I've already done that. Checked on my list, so I'm not being a hypocrite. If you are non-white, CPR training, but that should be motivation to get this problem solved immediately. Let's see. Getting to the book specifically, American Sirens. You already kind of told us, 9/11, the event, 2001 September, planes, World Trade Center, that event motivated you to make some changes, and you end up going to Atlanta and working as a paramedic for some years there. How in that journey do you end up hearing about Freedom House?
It was after I'd already gotten out. I'd written a memoir about what it was like to be, on an ambulance in Atlanta for Grady. It was a very singular experience. And so I wrote a book about it. Someone who read it said, "Hey, I read your book, thought it was interesting. Do you know how all that began? Have you heard of Freedom House?" I had not heard of Freedom House. I wasn't aware of anybody who had heard of Freedom House. So I started researching, and I realized very quickly that no one had sat down and collected this story. And I didn't yet know what it was. I had sort of just gotten into it, but I was pretty certain that there was something substantial behind it. I wanted to know. So I just started doing research on my own.
Research. Love it. If I could just pause, the Pittsburgh Courier. Wow. I mean, they have come up every flipping program. It doesn't matter the subject matter. Wow. They are an amazing read. If you want to study racism, white supremacy, you should check out the Pittsburgh Courier. They, I'm sure, have reams on the Freedom House. Pretty much anything that you want to think of that happened 20th century related to racism, white supremacy. Like, wow, the Pittsburgh Black journalists. Did you want to share anything, Pittsburgh Courier? Did you check out any of their sources in doing your research?
I was not able to get a ton of their articles. It was kind of funny. They have a huge presence in the city of Pittsburgh, particularly leading up to urban renewal, so through the 50s. But they did not cover the story of Freedom House substantially. And if they did, I was not able to track down many of their stories, unfortunately. So it was, you know, it was difficult trying to get sources from them.
Oh, dang. The sources that are available are amazing. I wish, that would seem like, yeah, if they were still in operation, I'm sure they would have had a paragraph or a sentence about Freedom House, at some point during that time period. That would, yeah, do some, maybe if I get to put that on the bucket list to get to Pittsburgh to do some digging to see if that is the case. Let's see, I'm gonna skip into chapter 2 to kind of get you to tell us why you centered John Moon. He's kind of one of the main, characters, in this book, protagonist, I would say. This is kind of the very beginning, of chapter 2. You write, Mr. Moon began his day on April 2nd, 1949, the first of two children for Elzora and Clinton Moon. By the time his sister June was born 2 years later, the family lived just north of downtown in a tangle of unpaved side streets and alleyways known as Buttermilk Bottom. Woo! How to describe the bottom? It was a mid-century urban neighborhood banished by decree and neglect to a 19th century existence named for the smell of sewage backflowing into the street and whose 2,000 residents, African Americans, mostly worked as help in the nearby mansions. By the time John came along, most of those big houses were gone, victims either to fire or progress, and so jobs like electricity and phone or trash service were something people in Buttermilk Bottom didn't have. Occasionally, because they could, drunk white men drove through at night firing guns. Man, just because we have had a bunch of shootings, I'll read that last sentence one more time. Occasionally, woo, because they could, drunk white men drove through at night firing guns. Why is John Moon one of the main characters? I'd say the main character of the book.
Well, part of it is for what you just read. You know, John's trajectory from where he's born to where he is today in so many ways really personifies this journey that Freedom House went on. You know, it begins in a neighborhood that the U.S. had decided they didn't need, and so they paved it over. It was, you know, something that, you know, prior to urban renewal, it is a neighborhood that had been neglected to the point that, you know, in the 1950s, if you have a place in the dead center of a major metropolitan area that doesn't have electricity or running water. And that's where he starts out. He makes his way to Pittsburgh after having been adopted and grows up, you know, in the midst of the civil rights movement, buys into the promise of the 60s, graduates from high school, sees that all the things that he thought were going to happen, all the change and equality that he thought were on his doorstep are in fact not on his doorstep, and that if he wants anything, he's going to have to go out and demand it. And he has no idea what that means or how to do it. He just knows he's going to do it. And it takes the form of an ambulance. And in so many ways, that is really the story of Freedom House. You know, when you speak to the people who are involved, time and again, what they will say was, yeah, I didn't know what an ambulance was. No, I didn't know what a paramedic was, but I recognized in this strange new job a way for the world to have to take notice of me. And that message is certainly carried in John's story. The lasting legacy of Freedom House is certainly carried in John's story.
Indeed, for folks who if you read the book, American Sirens, Maybe we can get Mr. Moon on the program. I felt like, man, we read the book and everything. Like, if he's down, maybe we can audition so you can see if we behave and if we, you know, ask correct questions and what have, we can get Mr. Moon on the program. Because, I mean, wow, he does, he is an inspiring figure to see it. Buttermilk Bottom, where occasionally, I don't even know what that means. Like, where did you get that from? Is that, did he tell you this or?
No. Now, there are somebody did an oral history of the area, and I was reading excerpts of it, and there was a woman who described having been a child, and that, you know, I don't think she used the word occasionally, but the way that the sentence rolled, it felt as if she was saying every once in a while, you just have to keep your head down because they would come through. And of course, why did they do that? Because, you know, you know why they did that. They did it because they could. The idea that could happen, that you had to just be on the lookout because every once in a while that might happen, to me felt almost in a way more inflammatory than if it was a daily event. The fact that it could be a capricious event was almost more horrifying.
Heard this before, all of this, in fact, even the name, the Bottoms, they've got tons of places where that's where they warehouse the Negroes, James Lowen's book. But that's also in Isabel Wilkerson's The Warmth of Other Suns. She says the exact same thing about areas where black people are warehoused in places like Mississippi and Louisiana, where occasionally, and it's almost the same language, occasionally, white people just for the fun of it would come through and you just duck and hope, you know, you don't get caught by a stray bullet. Reading more important than watching television. And that part about why it was named Buttermilk Bottom. Now, I mentioned Harriet A. Washington medical apartheid. I could have also mentioned a terrible thing to waste, which is environmental racism. That is exactly what she talked about. Oh, yeah, where you got all these. Oh, what is that noxious stench? Oh, I can't breathe. I can't breathe. Yes, we know. Buttermilk Bottom. You continue. This is, actually, I'm going a little bit out of order, so I'm backing up. This is still Mr. Moon, central figure. So you talk about what, you know, how does he even want to do this to get to Freedom House and his journey. Chapter 1, you write, why John was in the hospital that night had as much to do with the mundane realities of scheduling as it did with pure unforeseen chance. Life as an orderly wasn't inspiring, but it was steady and honest and wouldn't have been that bad as far as first-ish jobs go if it hadn't been for the fact that every day the important work of saving lives was happening all around him. Initially built to serve the city's Jewish population, Montfiore had joined the ranks of research and teaching facilities in 1957 when it became part of the University of Pittsburgh's medical system. By the time John arrived, a little over a decade later, he was surrounded by technology and equipment, an assembly of minds and ideas that brought the full power of Western medicine to bear in the battle to preserve human life. The spirit of wonder and excitement, that glamour was in the air, and it buoyed everyone around him. The doctors were young and perched atop a pedestal. When not teaching patients, they were chasing the nurses who seemed dead set on marrying a doctor, which made them easy, almost jubilant prey. I'm skipping a little bit. The orderlies, talking about John and other black males, for the orderlies, almost all of them who were black, it was different. John was at the bottom, once again, of the ladder, near to it at least, one step from the janitors, depending on who was asking. Orderlies were a necessary evil, something to be tolerated and utilized, but never engaged or included. Useless. Something went missing from a patient's room, and then the first glance of suspicion was always cast at the orderlies. They're known for stealing things, you know. I thought this was a great context for how, when you talk about he first sees his first set of paramedics, but this could have been his life for the next 30 years or until he was accused, wrongly or not, for stealing something from a patient, yes?
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, and this was a step up, you know. He had started out in a steel mill and got there and realized very quickly that he was never going to be promoted. So he entered into the to the job of an orderly with the hope of you know, providing a stepping stone for himself. And he got there and he realized that, yes, medicine is this wonderful world where all kinds of things can happen, but it's just simply not going to happen to me. And, you know, that's the sort of sense of frustration that he's in when, you know, when I talk to him and I say, what is it like? You know, tell me what it's like to be an orderly. He didn't talk about what it was like to be an orderly. He talked about what everybody else was doing, which tells you that what it means to be an orderly is to sit around and look at people with great opportunities and sort of stare through the window and look at the warmth that's going on inside the house while you're out on the front lawn. And that's the position that he was in. And, you know, into his life walked two young men who changed everything for him.
Hmm. You give lots of detail. He follows these guys and goes, gets training so that he can join the Freedom House. We'll get to all of that. But you give context as we're going along through here. And I was stunned. I mean, this is a new book. So, I mean, hey, this is from chapter 8. You're talking about the cholera epidemic, kind of given some of the history of medical advances and what have you. So you talking about cholera when it reached the UK in 1831. Cholera still had no identifiable cause or cure. People were terrified. It killed quickly and indiscriminately. Widespread fear of infection, along with anger over the government's inability to stop it, led residents to distrust Parliament and embrace conspiracy theories. Edicts from public health officials were seen as threats and ignored, while rumors that doctors admitted patients into the hospital just so they could kill and dissect them, something called burking, spread almost as quickly as the disease itself. In some cities, the public rioted. What in the COVID-19? Why is this even in the book, man?
Yeah, you know, it's funny. I'm writing this in 2020, 2021, and all this is happening around us. And, I mean, it was really, on the one hand, it was instructional to see that nothing changes. On the other hand, it was incredibly depressing to see that nothing changes. You know, where we were with people's reaction to COVID is where we were with people's reaction to cholera. And it's really quite stunning. People will find a way to blame the government anytime something goes wrong. They will find a way to say, no, it's not. This isn't a real problem. It's something, you know, it's them. It's them coming for us. They want something from us. You know, cholera is suspected to have come from at least from what I can tell from India. And so that plays into it. It's this idea of like, well, hold on. This isn't a Western disease. This isn't a European disease. This is some exotic thing. And, you know, it's coming from somewhere else, and it's of somebody else, and it's being brought to us. And if it exists at all, it exists only to get us. And we're not sure that we're even, you know, capable of catching it. We think this is simply a way for the government to gain control of us. And it was really listening to those words, reading those words was exactly what we were watching every day on television.
I highlighted that sadly. I was stymied. The term that I have coined, white defiance, because this is one where I just have not seen, especially here in the U.S., but even globally, I have not seen mobs of black people, non-white people out in the street. I'm not going to wear a mask. You're not going to make my child wear a mask. I have not seen that. I have seen thousands and thousands of people, exactly what I just read. Buzzing, conspiracy theories, it's 5G and all that. And the racist component, because he said with cholera, this is something from India and whatever, and conspiracy. That they've had reports as well that white people were not going to get vaccinated. We think this is some Negro disease. In fact, they said when it started being reported that black people initially were more susceptible. So, not getting that. This is some black thing. I'm good. Like, to hear that there is a pattern of that sort of behavior specifically with individuals classified as white. wow, that is, am I misinterpreting or with anything from your text in terms of how I'm reading the, what you just wrote in American Sirens in terms of what's happening right now? And have you seen any evidence of thousands and thousands of non-white people going out and protesting in this manner?
No, unfortunately, your reading of it is directly correct. You know, I mean, and that is certainly, again, it is a thing that we are seeing again. And it is a very difficult thing to wrap your head around.
It's staggering. It really is. Reading is more important than watching television. Oh, my goodness. Staggering in the worst way. Oh, my God. And another reason, this problem has got to be solved. I mean, moving forward, American Sirens, our guest, Kevin Hazzard. This is chapter 12. So we're progressing along here. Dr. Peter Safar, I hope I'm saying his name correctly. Safar. Safar, thank you. Dr. Safar gets involved and he wants to share his technologies and he's pioneering doing mouth to mouth and hey, cardiac arrest, this is a big problem. So we move ahead. This is chapter 12. Nearly a year to the day after his initial inspiration, Safar, say it again.
Safar.
Flew to Los Angeles to formally present his findings as he introduced to a panel of doctors the method of resuscitation that would ultimately save millions of lives around the world. The Soviet Union launched Sputnik into orbit, a chance confluence of events that marked October 1957 as both the dawn of the space age and also the birth of modern CPR. Safar's own recollection, the results landed like a bombshell in the U.S. and Europe. Global curiosity about both CPR and the man who devised it sent Peter and his wife Eva on a whirlwind tour of Australia, New Zealand, Indonesia. C-E-Y-L-O-N, still learning? What's the correct pronunciation?
Ceylon,
thank you. Egypt, Lebanon, and Europe. I had never even heard of Peter Safar. Did not know. I'm CPR trained. I didn't know. Like, he's the model that they use and everything. Like, gee whiz. Like, this is stunning to hear about this guy. Can you kind of give listeners some of his background and why he felt so compelled to preserve life?
Yeah, you know, he's one of those things, one of those frustrating parts of the story where you kind of keep shaking your head saying, how did this all this history disappear? Yeah, this is a man who's nominated three times the Nobel Prize in Medicine. He, you know, as you said, he developed CPR by himself. So he's an Austrian-born anesthesiologist. Both his parents were doctors. During World War II, they have all sorts of trouble. Germany rolls into Austria very early in that conflict. And Safar's mother has Jewish ancestry. So she is what the Germans refer to as a Mischling, which is basically translates as mixed thing. And so she loses her job. His father refused to return the Nazi salute. He loses his job. Despite that, Safar is drafted into the army and essentially is going to be sent to the Eastern Front, which he knows almost instinctively is a death sentence. So he basically fakes a medical situation to get himself out of it and, you know, just barely escapes duty in the German army. When that war is over with, he has this tremendous sense of survivor's guilt. You know, millions of people have died all around him. He is seeing at close hand the effects of the war. He is beginning to learn the realities of the Holocaust. Basically he says to himself, if all these people died and I live, there has to be some reason for me to have lived. Something good needs to come out of my living. So he dedicates his, you know, pretty considerable brain power and all of his energy into saving lives. And the first way he does that when he comes to the U.S. is design CPR. You know, what we had at the time simply didn't work. It was a positional kind of thing. You would just try to, you know, manipulate someone's body, hoping that moving them around would bring air into the lungs, which of course did nothing. He knew it did nothing. He set up a series of tests to prove that it did nothing, but in its place, he suggested rescue breathing, which, you know, was new and a lot of people did not think was going to work. He proved that it worked by, you know, he basically got volunteers and he said, look, I'm going to sedate you. I'm going to paralyze you and I'm going to keep you alive for 8 hours with a Boy Scout who's never heard of rescue breathing. And I'm going to videotape this and you're going to be monitored the entire time. And we're going to use that information to prove to the world that this is viable. And it works, of course. And, you know, he trots out his results, which are, you know, beyond conclusive. He pairs rescue breathing with chest compressions, you know, and kind of in one fell swoop, you have CPR. So this is the sort of not only, you know, kind of maverick thinker, but I mean, almost insanely self-confident. I mean, to undertake a study like that when the whole world is going, nah, I'm not so sure you're right, you know, in your early 30s, and to do that, I mean, to that sort of self-confidence, that kind of belief in yourself it's not something I can wrap my head around. But, you know, he's that smart, he's that driven, and he's that determined to you know, give something back to humanity. And that's his, you know, his first step. The next one, of course, will be paramedics.
Inspiring. Yeah, I mean, doing this at a time where this experiment where his patients could have died. Someone had, you know, made an error or miscalculated or whatever. Like, are you sure this works? Like, hey, I wish Dr. Frances Cress Welsing was still with us. It would have been great to read some of this with her. I did want to mention context is so important. You have so much historical context as you kind of walk the Sputnik I just read in terms of events. Man, the autumn of 1957. You know what else is happening, Autumn?
Yeah. What's that?
The Little Rock Nine crisis. They had to send the federal troops in, and these little black boys and little black girls, all of that. That is right the entire year. Like Jackie Robinson commented, everybody talked about this, and I was like, wow, that should have been included. Because we could definitely have used some paramedics on the scene at Little Rock High, probably for the entire school year, but definitely October during this time. Like, oh my God, you still had mobs of the mobs. That's true. But I think at that point, October, you would have still had federal troops, the National Guard out to keep order and make sure that the racists aren't trying to kill nine little black children. I thought that was important context for what is also happening simultaneously. Moving forward, context, man, oh man, just for our listeners, because we have, I would say accidentally, but that can be, we've been right and exact. We have been talking about true crime and serious. They got that wacky Netflix series and all, man. I said, white culture, if it wasn't what they're talking about right now, Netflix in Wisconsin, and lo and behold, I get the reading. Mr. Hazzard says, claiming to speak for the forgotten Americans, the non-shouters, the non-demonstrators, people who felt under siege during the long, dark night of the 60s. Nixon said, enough is enough, and America, faced with a weakening economy, a wider war in Vietnam, oil embargoes, the Manson murders. Shortly, and a general sense that somehow the country had lost its way, agreed with him. Look at that. White Syria, wherever, and Charles Manson was trying to start a race war, helter skelter, and became a whole celebrity for the next 60 years. Couldn't have been O.J. Simpson. Let's see. Manson got included for context, right? He's an important figure, right? Yes. Anything to?
I mean, that Nixon quote felt very much of today. And, you know, Manson fits right into this story, just as you said. I mean, he is of a piece of the things that are happening in the late 60s.
Everything related to racism, white supremacy, and the long, dark night of the 60s. That is in quotes. That's not Kevin Hazzard. Sorry, I almost said doctor. You're not a doctor. Skipping ahead, you write, this is chapter 14, so we're starting to get the Freedom House together, which is stunning, and John Moon and his colleagues. Dr. Saffer is going to get funding for all of this. If you're going to have paramedics and those ambulances and everything else, stethoscopes, you need money for all of that. So you write, Bill Hallin's arrival coincided with the dawn of the civil rights era, and his mission was very much in step with the times. Asked to define the aim of the fund, he once said, what we are searching for is some method of lessening the effects of bigotry and hatred. Specifically, the goal was to patch holes that systemic racism had cut into the public health safety net. Quite a metaphor. Can you unpack what Mr. Hanlon, he said hatred and bigotry. You wanted to be more specific. Give us the details.
Yeah, I mean, Phil can be pretty direct, and he at times gets very direct with how he feels about some of the politicians in that city. But, you know, he sort of stepped around it a little bit with what that organization's goal was. I mean, the reality is that systemic racism had created huge problems in terms of, like, very specifically in terms of delivery of healthcare. There was little to no access to healthcare for people living in the Hill District specifically. And that's what they were trying to do. He's looking around and he knows that, you know, sort of keeping in line with what we're talking about here, if you need an ambulance, if you need a ride to the hospital in a neighborhood in which, you know, you cannot get a cab, you know, it's where August Wilson wrote Jitney, you're definitely not going to get an ambulance. And the quote unquote ambulance that will be coming to you is staffed by the police. And this neighborhood, the Hill District, has a very acrimonious relationship with the police department. The city of Pittsburgh is America's first city to have a consent decree placed upon its police. So, you know, that relationship between the cops and people living in the Hill had never been good. And then when you have a medical emergency and you are in need of help, the people you have to reach out to are the police officers. This is obviously hugely problematic for people who are already struggling to have access to healthcare on a good day. Now suddenly they're trying to, you know, get healthcare on a bad day in an emergent situation. And that's kind of what Phil Hallin is looking at. He's looking at a neighborhood that, you know, has been, you know, scraped down to the dirt, 8,000 people displaced by an urban renewal program that built a civic center and a highway in exchange for homes. And that's what he is trying to find ways to fix. He knows that's the problem. He just doesn't know exactly what to do about it.
For a moment, I said, man, is he talking about Buttermilk Bottom? Like, oh, no, he's talking about Pittsburgh. Okay. Anywhere you go in the world, it sounds painfully similar. Talking about the Hill in Pittsburgh, American Sirens. Talking about the Hill, chapter 15, you write, in a place like the Hill District, where the world took a whole hell of a lot without ever giving back, where crime and poverty were at all-time highs, where people were referred to as unemployables. The sight of a young black man stepping from an ambulance in service of his community would restore a measure of dignity even to those who witnessed it. And as he blazed a trail for others to follow, that medic's achievements would reach far beyond the Hill, helping to stamp out the racist notion that it was a lack of ability, not inequality, that held African Americans back. Super. I do have a question, but I think this is so important because John Moon and so many of the other folks who were, Darnella Wilson, so many of the folks who participated in this, that's like, man, we are going to show these white people I am not an unemployable. I am not an idiot. Like, if we could just get a chance, like, and we can do something to help black people. Like, we can give health. Everybody needs health services. That's a basic human right. We can do something to help black people. Like, that is, Your thoughts, Mr. Hazzard?
Yeah, it's, I mean, it's kind of staggering that that statement needed to be made at the time. You know, Jim McCoy, who is civil rights leader in Pittsburgh, who started Freedom House, that was his thinking. That was still Hallin's thinking, that we were in a position where you needed to enumerate that sort of thought and say, okay, this is specifically why we're going to be doing this. This is the need, more so than a job, that we need to find a way to return, you know, a measure of not pride to the community, but like sort of shine a light of pride outward to show the rest of the world, hey, this is what people here are capable of. If only you would take your foot off their neck for a second. It's really kind of staggering. And I mean, clearly, you know, we sit in much the same situation today.
You reminded me, August Wilson. That's right. He is Pittsburgh. I forgot all about it. Fences. For people who've seen the play, or they made it a movie now, so I guess you don't have to see the play. You've seen the play and or the movie that's set in Pittsburgh, too, where the main character, black male Troy, is complaining about racism. He spends his whole time in the play complaining about racism in Pittsburgh. Have you seen Fences?
Yes.
Is my memory bad? Doesn't he spend the whole play or movie complaining about racism in Pittsburgh?
Yeah, I mean, you know, the character in the movie that's played by Denzel, you know, he's got a lot of anger, and you know, it's all coming out, and it's, I mean, that's part of what makes it such a powerful performance.
Even the fences at the Hill District, Buttermilk Bottom, we fence the niggers in the worst places. Yes, have them be angry, and then we don't send ambulance services to them, unemployables. So I had my question connected to all of this. They get the bottom of this paragraph, so important. The medics' achievement, black medics' achievements, would reach far beyond the Hill, helping to stamp out the racist notion that it was a lack of ability, not inequality, that held African Americans back. Is that true? Does this stamp out white people? That's who, I mean, we really have to be talking about here. Is this true for white people? Do the achievements of Darnella Wilson, John Moon, Freedom House at large, does this stamp out racists' belief that black people, they are unemployables?
I don't know that anything stamps that out. I think that doesn't mean you don't try. I guess it doesn't mean you don't do what you have to do. But, you know, does witnessing something with your own eyes outweigh an irrational thought? I don't know. I mean, how does something rational outweigh the irrational? So I understand the sentiment. Perhaps I'm not quite or too much of a cynic to believe that that it can achieve its goals, but I don't know. I'm hesitant to say that anything really can wipe that sentiment out.
Oh, I definitely think this problem can be solved. I've been called cynical myself, whatever that means. We would not be chatting it up. I'd be preparing for a pumpkin pie and turkey and, you know, we're not turkey, vegan proud, so something plant-based, but we would not be chatting this evening if I didn't think this problem could be solved. I do think being accurate, because I've heard this sentiment for many years, and it's been popular for many, many, I think, centuries at this point, that, hey, if black people, if we go fight in this war, if we go and we take this class, if we scrub and we take 15 baths and we go to school and we speak proper English and we learn all the pronunciations and everything, hey, they will stop practicing racism. Wrong. That thinking, unfortunately, is still very prevalent in 2025. That is a total misunderstanding of white supremacy, racism, and what it means to be white. And that gets evidenced as we continue just reading with the book here. Moving forward, this, again, American Sirens journalist, former paramedic, Kevin Hazzard. This is from chapter 19 in the book. So we move forward. Man, this is important for so many reasons. To get this Freedom House going, we want to get black paramedics in. Serve the Hill District. They didn't even want to. White people didn't even want to serve black residents of Pittsburgh. You get over there. And we don't want to fund the Freedom House. You can at least take care of your own people. So they sit around and they think, what can we do to get funding? I know. Hire white people. They go find a white person. Who do they find? Bill Rain. Uh-oh. This is enough. I'm still learning. Rainovich? Is that it? Rainovich?
Yeah.
Oh, hey. Getting better. All right. So you're right. All that impressive history was in the past. When Rainovich arrived, the platoon was made up almost entirely of black men, and several of them, just days before he arrived, were beaten by a group of white Marines armed with axe handles. The men of his platoon were so skittish when he got there that they slept with their shovels next to them in bed. For a kid who grew up in a lily white suburb, did I say James Lowen Sundown Town before? Yikes. It was heavy and disorienting, but Rainovich was nothing if not easygoing. I will pause there. I had to read that because we just had Veterans Day. What in the world? Axe handles? Did he give you this in an interview?
Yeah. Yeah, he did. Was directly from him. I mean, it was, this is his first experience out of his parents' house. You know, he grew up in a small town in the suburbs of Pittsburgh. Winds up in the military because it's, you know, Vietnam's going on. People are getting drafted. He's doing what he can to try to avoid getting sent over. And I think he was trying to become like a radar operator or something. He didn't have the eyesight for it. And inadvertently finds himself as a corpsman, which, I mean, a corpsman attached to the Marines is just about the first guy to be sent over to Vietnam. And he hits the West Coast, and that is the environment that he finds himself in. He's the only white guy there, and they're all looking at him like, you know, prepare yourself because, you know, you've just entered into a different kind of world. And, you know, that was his military experience. He sort of toggled between this siege mentality that existed within the guys of his platoon and then this weird sort of other world where he's in a clinic dealing with young men who had tried to kill themselves in order to get a discharge from the military.
Wow. Context of Veterans Day. That's the sort of thing, like, we want to sit around and talk about Veterans Day and shake our finger in Colin Kaepernick's face, like, pause. That's why I read Jackie Robinson. Third time he can get mentioned. Or just read what this white man's experience was, Mr. Rainovich. I'm continuing. So after he gets out of Vietnam, and you talk about how many Vietnam vets and what have you, some of them who did have some medical experience because of that were saying, like, dang, we had better medical services there than here. Like, this is absurd. The white paper that came out during the 60s about the traffic fatalities and how they got better ambulance service and, you know, hey, we can do better. Let's make some improvements here. This is chapter 15. You write, so this is talking about Mr. Rainovich, for his new co-workers being part of an all-black organization had special meaning. Few had envisioned that something like it was even possible, and the pride they got from going into black communities and their own communities and bringing hope would stand as the crowning achievement of their careers. Freedom House wasn't just a job for them. It was a passion, an organization to which they owed a great debt. They weren't eager to see it change, and when Rainovich walked in, he represented change. Many were skeptical about the white people showing up. What were their motives? Where were their loyalties? Did they understand just how special this place was? Ultimately, it would come down to trust. If Rainovich was being sized up, he never felt it. He acted as if he belonged, and to his surprise, it seemed he did. In the dispatch room, on the trucks, nobody batted an eye. If medicine teaches you anything, it's that we all bleed red and die easy. I will stop there. Do you think, even today, or in fact, we could take the date off, as long as the system of white supremacy exists, do you think it's logical for any non-white person to have suspicion, use the word skepticism or skeptical, but to be skeptical, to be suspicious that anybody, I don't care if it is Mr. Rainovich, oh, you served with all the black people and you didn't beat them, right on, okay, still suspicious. Do you think it's logical for everyone classified as non-white to be suspicious of anyone who is classified as white, even yourself?
Sure, I would be.
Right on, right on. What else did Mr. Rainovich, did he tell you about his experience? Like, how did the black people in the Hill District, how did they respond to him when he first, when they cops out, did they care? Or they just, hey, we need help. You know, my cousin is down or my son is down. How did they respond to him?
I mean, if in an emergency, people tend not to care who's there as long as the person who's there knows what the heck they're doing. So he never noticed anything from the patients. The patients, surely, people in that neighborhood were well aware of what Freedom House was and what it stood for and what it meant. I'm sure had they found it strange to see a white guy step down from the ambulance. But again, if he was capable, if it is your child that is sick, I personally would not care. And he didn't seem to have any issues with patients. There was nothing that stood out to him with patients, although he did say years down the road after the city took over and it became an almost entirely white organization that within a couple of weeks the windows of his ambulance were broken out. So people were aware of the difference of who was treating them and how they were being treated. In terms of like his coworkers, I think that's probably a different and more complicated question. You know, from starting in 1970, the city halved their operating budget. So for an organization that was already stretching every dollar, suddenly every dollar became 50 cents. And, you know, early 70s, Richard Nixon is, you know, he has this incredibly unpopular war in Vietnam, is skyrocketing inflation. People are very restless. He's trying to look for some positive news story that he can put out there. And so he devises this system in which, you know, we're going to, any employer who hires a Vietnam veteran is going to get federal dollars. But of course, because it's a federal program, it needs to be an equal opportunity employer. And which meant that they would have to hire white people. So they sort of, you know, held their nose and did it. And when he walked through the door, people were aware of why he was there. But you know, I talked to John about that. I talked to George McCary. I talked to several people who I said, how did you feel about this guy coming in? And they said two things, you know, which, you know, I think just is, it sort of explains how complicated the situation. One, they would point back to again and again, how important it was, how important this organization was and how it was founded and how it was run and who ran it, how important it was to them. But then also they would say, well, you know, when it came down to it, on an emergency call and all hell's breaking loose, can I trust the guy? Can I rely on the guy next to me? And Bill proved himself to be someone he could rely on. So, you know, left to their own devices, would they have integrated the organization? I don't see any evidence that they would have. But of all the people who could have walked through the door, was Rainovich perhaps the best option? I think he probably was.
I'm going to nab some of the folks who dialed in with questions, but ooh-wee. I love it. Like, whew, giddy for vegan pumpkin pie in a couple days. I do make a pretty mean pumpkin pie, plant-based pumpkin pie. When white people say something that contradicts what's in their book, Mr. Kevin Hazzard, he just said that in an emergency situation, people tend not to care about the person and their race or what have you that's providing care. Chapter 24. Oh, I love it. I love it. That's beautiful sound clip. That's sound clip ready. Here we go. Got to read this one correctly. Hope they don't have any crazy pronunciations. Here's where things... Oh, love it. Look at that. Here's where things get complicated. Running calls downtown where there were stores and businesses, entire blocks without a single black face, meant that each ring of the red emergency phone raised the specter that the person on the other end of the line was white. This woman having chest pain at the end of a carpeted hall in a high-rise was white. But George McCary just walked in and started talking like usual, making himself right at home. John was thinking his way through all the possible life threats hiding behind the symptoms, the treatment algorithms to deal with them, the drugs, and which hospital to go to. He was already kneeling by the woman's side when he really looked into her eyes for the first time and realized something was wrong. He started to explain chest pain and heart attacks, the diagnostic capabilities of the EKG machine at his side, and the imperative of the next step, oh God, which was to unbutton her blouse so he could place the monitor's electrodes on her skin. White skin. She started shaking her head. He wasn't going to touch her. Certainly not on her chest. And there definitely would be no unbuttoning of any blouses at all. Her eyes flicked from John to George and back. Maybe she was just unsettled. Chest pains are said to be accompanied by a sense of impending doom. But then it's possible, too, she'd heard the rumors that Freedom House wasn't just moving patients around the city, but moving drugs as well. Whatever you wanted, they had it. And when they weren't selling drugs, which probably was most of the time, they were running dice games. Nobody knew who started the rumors, but John speculated it was someone at City Hall, and he wasn't the only one. Crazy as they sounded, the rumors wouldn't die. They fed into the stereotypes that were alive and... Oh, I'm sorry, listeners. How many times I gotta... Alive and well in the early 70s, and from those stereotypes, it was only a short leap to believing they weren't just practicing medicine in the back of those ambulances. They were doing the unthinkable. And now, here they were, as expected, trying to take her shirt off. I'm stopping just to fast forward. Do you really have to do this, raping niggers? So John tries to keep his composure. We have to get him on the program. Like, my God. So sometimes there was confusion, but this wasn't confusion. It was uglier. It was disgust and hate. The woman who may well have been having a heart attack was physically recoiling in their presence, when all they wanted, the very reason she called them in the first place, was to help. John gave her the nicest smile he had. Without care, you could die. He looked around the room, and we're the only ones here to help. So it's either us or... As in, either you let us do our job, or you could die right here on the floor of your office. Maybe make a mess of this nice carpet. I will stop there, she allows the treatment, but I mean, whew, I'm having a heart attack. Ugh. No. Raping black men, like, oh my God. Like, I can just give a standing ovation. John Moon, if you want a demonstration of keeping your composure, John Flippin' Moon. Wow. Highest commendation. Hopefully we can get him on the program. So you remember what you said about people generally don't care about treatment? I know this wasn't a one-time thing.
Oh, no. This was something that they dealt with. I don't know how often, but it was not a one-time thing. It was a recurring problem that they had.
City Hall? I mean, that's not the homeless wino down the block is saying that, you know, we're smuggling heroin or whatever. In the City Hall is trafficking rumors that just won't die every day. We got a new round. City Hall is trafficking these rumors?
Yeah, I mean, their intention from the beginning was to try to starve this thing out. You know, they thought that Freedom House was, you know, something of a trend that would go away if they put up some resistance. And it simply wasn't going away. And so they kept upping the resistance. And it came, you know, among the things that they did was try to poison the public against what was quite clearly not only very successful, but very popular. It was popular in Pittsburgh. It was popular in Pennsylvania. It was popular in the U.S. and it was popular in other countries. I mean, they were invited to a conference in Mainz, Germany. So this was what these guys were doing was tremendously successful, and the whole world saw it. And yet at home, the city that they were serving was led by people that did not care for being represented by this group of men from the Hill. And so they put up fierce resistance. And as part of that resistance, they said, well, somebody, you know, the genesis of the rumors is unknown, but I mean, somebody, you know, positioned well enough to spread them in all corners, you know, said, hey, look, who knows what those guys are doing back there? They're probably, you know, they're probably selling drugs. They're probably gambling back there. And then who knows what else? And, you know, and I asked John, I said, you know, that sounds so ridiculous. How did you feel about that? He said, those are the sort of rumors that stick.
Especially if you are a black male, and it doesn't matter if there's any evidence, it doesn't matter if it's true. And especially, like I said, that's not the wino. That's not the, I don't know, the folks on the back pew at the parish. The mayor, possibly, the council member, City Hall? Like, what? Who would be saying this? Why would the mayor be saying this if it's not true? Why would the council member be saying this if it's not? They must know something. Yeah. Mayor, oh, my. Before I nab the call, just to give further context about this, so you got the rumor component that, yeah, they're smuggling drugs and everything else. And then you have the other component that's just more flagrant. Mayor Flaherty did pass, and this is millions of dollars of federal funding that they could have got, get all the ambulances and stethoscopes and everything else, cotton balls, but the mayor did pass up these millions in federal dollars. His reasoning was that most of these grants required the city to chip in money of its own. This he simply wouldn't do. He felt Freedom House should be self-sustaining, a demand made of no other branch of public safety. Without asking for a dime in return, the city spent $19 million a year on the police department and $12 million a year on the fire department. In fact, they spent twice as much money every year on dog catching, about $100,000, as they were now spending on Freedom House. Dog catching. He repeats it. I'm just repeating it because, dang, we've heard this one many, many times. Dogs being treated better than black people. Name of Mike Vick. skipping ahead a little bit, he continues, by suggesting Freedom House be allowed to move into wealthier neighborhoods, Mitch inadvertently dragged the funeral homes and private ambulance companies into the fight. To those groups, this was a cash cow, not a mission. They argue the government-run services inhibit free enterprise and lobbied against making EMS a public service similar to the police and fire departments. Free emergency medical treatment was socialized medicine, they insisted, and would brainwash people into voting for such dangerous concepts as universal health care. Richard Dixon, head of a company called Tri Rivers Ambulance, said government funding gave Freedom House an unfair advantage that pushed for-profit services out of business. This, he argued, was unconstitutional. Dixon recalled the good old days, almost sounds like MAGA, 5 or 6 years ago when Freedom House had one ambulance serving the Hill District because private companies and the police wouldn't go there. Now there are 5 or 6 ambulances operating all over the district. The implication was clear. It was fine for Freedom House to cover an area nobody else wanted to cover and help people no one else wanted to help. But the moment they set their sights on wealthier clientele, well, that was unacceptable and possibly even un-American. Lots of obstacles. And this, again, when I say now, greatly pained about racism, white supremacy, Mr. Hazzard?
Again, like I said, when you read the things that pop up, it's very difficult to imagine that there are many people who are greatly pained.
Let's see. Our caller 2262, did you have a question for Kevin Hazzard, author of American Sirens, tremendous history on the development of the paramedics in the U.S. and really the world? This amazing history that's totally obliterated, and then all of these black people that were right there literally kicked to the curb. Our caller 2262, did you have a question for Kevin Hazzard? You should be with us.
May I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Gus, for taking my call. Greetings to everyone on the line, listeners and the callers, and greetings to our guests. Mr. Hazzard, I'm sorry. Thank you for spending some time with us. I'd like to start off by asking about the Freedom House. You said that you were informed by an individual. Could you tell us, was this individual white or non-white?
You know, I wish I knew. It was an email that I got from somebody I did not know. It was, you know, just someone who reached out to me who had read my first book and said, hey, have you ever heard of this?
Okay. My next question would be, you said you worked at Grady Hospital located in Atlanta, Georgia, am I correct?
Yes, yeah.
Okay. Are you familiar with some of the, I guess, statements made about that hospital as far as the namesake, Grady?
No, I don't believe so.
Are you aware that this individual was also a suspected racist who made statements about black people that were disparaging?
I'm not, but let's see. He was maybe 19th century. I'm assuming he lived in the 19th century. White guy in Atlanta. That's probably what I would expect.
Are you familiar with some of the health issues that individuals identified as black suffered at this hospital in Atlanta, Georgia?
No, I'm not.
You said before that the CPR, I'm sorry, I'm currently dropping right now, one moment. Okay. Thank you for your patience. You said earlier, CPR, when Gus asked you about the CPR, you said people of color will possibly have, a difficult time receiving this. Why didn't you say black people?
I don't remember the context of the statement.
The statement was, go ahead, sir.
No, go ahead. No, just.
Right. You were talking about, the practice of CPR in, black areas and how it was not, black people are less likely to receive this type of CPR. And you said, you used the term people of color. Why didn't you use the term black people?
I don't know that I was the one who's talking. That was somebody else's study. I was not, I was not part of that. I think that was am I wrong, Gus? That was a modern study about CPR today. I could be missing something.
Well, that's true. That report is, I guess, modern, recent, last few days.
Okay. First, prior to having heard that at the beginning of this program, I was not aware that that study took place. So I don't fully remember what the conversation was that we were having at the time, but, I don't know. If you're asking why I would use that term, I don't know who was involved in that study or who they were saying was less likely to get it. I don't know how much thought I put into it in the moment because, again, I was speaking on something that I was not familiar with.
Okay. I guess that'll be it for tonight with my question. Thank you guys for taking my call, and I'll mute my line.
For sure. Much obliged, sir. Our caller, retired firefighter in Florida. Bet he knows CPR, or at least had to at one point. Retired firefighter in Florida, did you have a question for Mr. Kevin Hazzard?
Greetings, everyone. My question to the guest is to ask him, do you think the reason why non-white black people have been, for right now, I'll just use the metaphor, pushed aside from not getting those jobs or encouraged, to pursue the profession is because how lucrative it is to be a firefighter, paramedic, as far as a payment is concerned, and also the retirement is very good from that standpoint. Do you think that, and if it's so, give me some commentary on that.
Well, I will say from my experience, when I started, I could have made a lot more money if I had quit my job and gone to Starbucks. When I quit, I was making $20 an hour. So from my experience, it's not a lucrative place. Where I worked, there was no retirement at all. I'm sure that at a fire department, that might be different. People might make more money. Surely they have pensions because it's a city job. And any time that there's, let's say, a pension benefit, which I guess is maybe one of the more you know, sort of one of the nicer parts of that job, one of the nicer perks, then people who have it probably try to give it to people they know and, you know, friends or whatever. So it, you know, would not surprise me in any way if firefighters were, you know, sort of looking out for their own in that regard. But again, that was not my experience. Where I worked, it was not a lucrative place, and you definitely did not have a pension if you stayed in it.
Yeah, well, I was speaking from the standpoint of most large fire departments have merged into doing just more than just fighting fires. It's fire rescue. And therefore, sure. Most of the employees are both firefighters and paramedics.
Yeah, that's certainly been a trend recently to move the ambulance over to the fire department. And I guess that's probably a product of, you know, there are fewer fires out there, and the fire department's got to justify its budget. And, you know, here's this ambulance that's running tons and tons of calls. And so it makes more sense to merge them. And, you know, surely that is a much more lucrative way to do the job.
Yes, and from my experiences, it's not as encouraged teenagers that are in high school and in the means of coming out of high school as much as it is, especially with black male sports, is much more encouraged as opposed to something of that nature where you don't even have to go to college for it. But anyway, that was my question to ask you. So I'm finished.
Much obliged, retired firefighter in Florida. I'm not surprised to hear that at all, that wouldn't be a profession marketed to black children, non-white children in total. I had to ask about the hair. I don't know if people have asked you this. You've been doing interviews and what have you, promoting the book and all. The hair, black males and their hair, comes up in peculiar ways in the text. I just wanted to ask, did you note that? What do you think? So this is at the very beginning of chapter 30. This is Dr. Nancy Caroline. You write, things did not start well. Nancy's first memorable interaction with her new charges came just days into the job when the Freedom House crew chiefs, three very imposing, bearded, machismo characters whom she'd never met, barged into her office to air their grievances. This is a white woman describing these black males at the Freedom House that she's coming to take over. This is later down the line, almost at the end when it's about to be shut down. And then the hair thing, it comes up again. So this is later on in the text. This is in the epilogue. So this is later on. Freedom House has been shut down, and Mr. John Moon, he's trying to move on with his career and trying to see if he can hang on to his job as a medic, even though they are deliberately trying to get rid of as many of these black males as possible. Mr. Hazzard writes, John's parents, never entirely certain what this wayward son of theirs did for a living, swelled with pride when they learned he was a supervisor. John worked hard to live up to the post. He tried to be fair, to be helpful. He kept his truck clean and his uniform impeccable. The beard was gone, and slowly over time, the afro went away too. He was older but still young and had already pulled himself through enough trouble for two lifetimes. The hair component is minuscule in terms of all of the really important things and people, Darnella Wilson and George McCary and all of these folks, John Moon. But what in the world? And it's in both of the, when Dr. Nancy Caroline is speaking, it's these bearded machismo males. And then for his parents, like, he's kind of unruly and wayward. Well, at least he got rid of that beard. At least he got rid of that afro. Like, what is going on with black male hair here?
Yeah, I found that interesting. You know, I was born in 77, so the afro is a thing that, you know, was kind of always around in my lifetime. But to hear John describe it, for him, growing that hairstyle out was not simply, it was a very determined choice. And it was one that he thought was making a statement about who he was, about how he felt about the world, about how he wanted the world to interact with him. You know, he felt it was a symbol of defiance. And then Nancy, who, you know, wound up having a great relationship with people at Freedom House, was initially very intimidated. She grew up in this, you know, suburb of Boston, very far away from the Hill District. And, you know, that quote from her first interaction, that's what she noted. She noted the beards. And John would always talk about the beards. You know, he would always say, you know, in come these guys with afros and beards. I mean, to him, that was sort of a very revolutionary look. You know, he refers to Angela Davis several times when he talks about people that he revered as a kid. And so I think for him, it was a symbol of defiance. I think to Nancy, who was just entering this world, to her, it was something to be intimidated by. And I think for John's parents, it was the way he dressed and the way he wore his hair, the way he spoke, the way he acted. They saw it as him, you know, those were products of this younger generation that they did not understand, that was very rebellious. And that made them worried. They were concerned for what that would mean for the future of their child. So, you know, all these different people had very different interpretations of something that seems quite minor, but in reality was not minor at all.
Fascinating. What? In so many ways that, we've got our own rebellious Negro right here. That fella that we just heard from, retired firefighter, he got in trouble. Fire department down in Florida for having a lip beard. The only reason, and I'm pretty serious about this, if I had read your book at any other time, I may not have asked you, because there's so many, Darnella Wilson, man, there's so many important components to the book. I probably would have said, we got other things. But the great Bill Russell just passed away. We're reading his memoir, Second Wind. In that book, and his prime is this era. In that book, he said he grew a meager beard. The NBA, white executives at the NBA were so mad they considered making a rule to outlaw beards. I was stunned. He said he let his beard grow out just a little bit, and then Wilt Chamberlain grew up. And now we've got two giant niggers when the NBA had just started allowing black players to play. Now we've got two of them, and they've got beards. We got to make a rule. Wow. I keep saying her name. Darnella Wilson. I tried to see if I could find the YouTube of her doing the national anthem at the Pittsburgh Steelers game. I'm totally against football and all that, but I mean, I am going to nab that one. Who is Darnella Wilson, please?
She, 1975, she's a recent high school graduate whose older sister was close friends with Walt Brown, who is, he's one of the original paramedics, but he's also one of the supervisors. He's a very important part of the organization. A lot of people look to him for, you know, for leadership, and he just had sort of a big outgoing personality that everybody was drawn to. And Walt walked into her house one day over the summer, and, you know, he goes to see her older sister, and he sees Darnella sitting on the couch. Again, she's graduated from high school. She's got nothing to do for the summer. And what he sees is this sort of, wide-eyed but bright young woman who's wasting time. You know, Walt's a very aggressive person. And in his mind, if you've got the ability, then you need to be using your time wisely. And he doesn't take no for an answer. He tells her, look, I'm going to get you a job. She says, I don't want a job. I just want to relax and enjoy my summer. That's not what he sees for her. So he essentially just, you know, tells her, you're coming with me. And they go down to Freedom House, and he gets her a job as a dispatcher, which she does not know what a dispatcher is. She doesn't know, you know, like most people, she didn't know what a paramedic was. She'd never had any interaction with an ambulance. But immediately she arrives and she sees an organization that is run by people just like her from her neighborhood. And she, like everybody else who was working there, was immediately swept up in, you know, the excitement and the pride. And then she started wondering, well, what is it they do when they leave here? And so she starts little by little to get on the ambulances and go out on calls. And she watches guys who generally she knows only for sitting around the station talking, which, you know, in between calls, people are hanging out. There's a lot of trash talk going on. She thinks it's all fun and games. And then she sees their demeanor change when they're on an emergency call. She realizes not only the seriousness of the work, but the talent, the skill, and the dedication of the people involved, and that, you know, right then and there, her path is set. She will eventually go on to, you know, have a long career as an EMT and a paramedic, a long career as a nurse. But she is one of the last people to have joined Freedom House, was in the midst of trying to become a paramedic when the city took it over. And the city, though, they said, okay, well, we will take all of your employees will come to us at their current level. That's not what they do with her. They send her to the jail where she is, you know, she's just turned 18 and she's told to sit outside cells and monitor guys who've been arrested and are awaiting trial and are looking at this, you know, young 18 year old girl making, you know, wildly inappropriate comments. And it's a very traumatic experience for her, one that she, to this day, she has a very difficult time discussing. But she wanted to become a paramedic. And so despite that experience, and though she knew she had to show up every day and do that, she put herself through school and she held on, and she eventually became, you know, a paramedic. And again, went on to become a nurse.
Darnella Wilson. There's so many folks in this book who, it's just extra. George McCary, so many, everybody, really. Name all of the victims of racism who participated in this Freedom House project. It's just extraordinary. And just to think about that, an 18, and I'm glad he said, because most of the time people don't do that. What words, I've been saying that the whole time, words are so important. Most of the time they would have said, woman. Darnella Wilson, 18 years old, that is a girl. To send her to a prison, like, what? I'm training to be a, what? At a time when you probably don't even have very many female guards working at correctional facilities anyway, but to send her to a prison at, if I didn't know better, I would think, dang, are they just trying to get her to quit? Anywho, with Darnella Wilson, I did want to pause just to read this quickly. You said her father owned a restaurant called Wilson's Barbecue, and through parties attended by mayors and the well-connected by people of means, Darnella was never sure if it was that their restaurant was so successful or their skin so light, but the Wilsons enjoyed a level of prosperity and respect foreign to her new co-workers. Is she, because I haven't seen her, is she pale? Could she pass for white? Like, what are we talking about in terms of complexion?
I mean, she's lighter skinned, and, you know, a lot of her coworkers definitely were not. And, you know, she would look around the room and say, why is it that we were so well accepted? Why is it that my dad was able to host all these, you know, powerful political leaders in the city? And now I'm around a bunch of people who are really good at their jobs and are constantly being sniped at. What is the difference between the two of us? And, you know, she made that statement in passing. I kind of stopped and, you know, wanted to make sure that that's what she meant to say. And she repeated it. And again, she was not, you know, she was not certain that that was the reason, but, you know, she certainly had her suspicions.
Thank you for including that one. Black get back. Dr. Welzing used to say that all the time. There's lots of data on that. The darker you are, the worse you are treated. They even have that statistics for death row. The darker you are, the more likely you are going to get the chair. What is, we're saying terms and definitions, I almost got everything done to let you enjoy the rest of your Monday evening. What is spite selling?
So you discussed the patient earlier who did not want John and George to lay their hands on her. That was someone most likely coming from one of the suburbs of Pittsburgh. So, you know, as was the case in a lot of cities around America, there were covenants for a long time that said you could not, you could only sell your homes to white families. When those covenants were removed, suddenly people were buying homes in different areas. And so there were reports of various parts of the cities where if I didn't like my neighbor, I would sell my home to a black family because that would essentially be punishment to the neighbor that I didn't like, that he now has that as his neighbor. And that was going on. It was talked about in the newspapers where, you know, as populations around the city were starting to move and shift, the actual city of Pittsburgh, their population was contracting, suburbs were expanding. People who had always lived within the city were beginning to move out, and some of those people were black people. And spite selling, you know, quite simply is that's what it was. It was white residents selling their homes to black families in order to get back at neighbors that they didn't like.
Oh, I have to be muted sometimes because I have to cackle. I'm not as bad as Bill Russell, but whoo, man, I had a good chuckle both times when I read it, and then when I, this isn't footnoted either, so where did you get the reference that this spite selling was happening in Pittsburgh circa 1969-ish?
Nothing is footnoted, it's all endnoted. I'm pretty sure it's a Pittsburgh Post-Gazette article, but you could track that down through the endnotes. It was part of a series that was talking about the integration of Pittsburgh's outer suburbs, and that was something that was sort of mentioned almost in passing. You know, they were comparing two different families. That was really the thrust of the article, was these two different families who had moved to the suburbs. But the fact that I found most compelling was that one, because someone who's willing to do that, someone who believes that a black neighbor is so odious that you can spite sell your home, that is an intriguing psyche to put yourself into the shoes of when you imagine that person having an emergency and John Moon walking through the door.
Glad that was included as well. Certainly there are endnotes. For sure. That this is another one, sincerely and greatly pained. My question from this is, I've asked this one for a long time, so based on spite selling and much of the other content that we've heard, we've asked our guests, who do you think is more informed about what racism, white supremacy is, how it works? Do you think individuals classified as white are more informed about what racism is, how it works, or do you think non-white people are more informed about what racism is, how it works?
I would not think that white people are well informed about how it works. I think if you are not subject to something, then it is very easy for you to overlook it, ignore it, act as if it doesn't exist, or that it's a relic of another time that is not relevant to what's happening today. So I don't see a world in which you could say that the average white American is well informed of the realities of systemic racism.
I didn't say white American, just pointing that out, because white supremacy racism is a global problem, so I never use the phrase white American. You, in the text, the portion that I just read, spite selling, And even beyond that, you included the history of covenants, where it's literally written into the contract, we will sell you this property provided you do not sell to Negroes. And it'll be written in the contract, sometimes the way I said it, Negroes. With that, and what you just said and wrote, spite selling, that can't be a concept. That psyche can't be so intriguing. The individual classified as white who is so disgusted with Negroes, and I'm so upset with my neighbor who's classified as white, that to get them to even know I'm doing something I'm not supposed to do, that will show them that right there, that individual can't be ignorant about racism, white supremacy. Is that true, Mr. Hazzard?
I certainly not ignorant of racism. I guess when I think of white supremacy, maybe this is just a difference of word usage, but when I think of that, I think of power structures. So I don't know that a lot of people who are not sort of a victim of a power structure would pay much attention to it. And that's what I mean by that. Are white people aware of racism? Sure, they might try to deny whatever it is that they have, but they're surely aware of it.
So you said they are aware of it. White people are aware of racism, but they deny it, a.k.a. they're lying and saying that they're not aware of it. You said that white people are aware of it?
Oh, sure. What I was referring to before was more the presence of a power structure that sort of keeps them aloft and keeps somebody underneath. I think that's an easier thing to sort of ignore than a baseline version of hatred.
Okay. Well, let's make sure that we're clear about terms, because I didn't say hatred either. What I said is, who do you think is more informed about what racism, white supremacy is and how it works? Do you think the people who are classified as white are more informed about that, or do you think the people who are non-white are more informed about that? And again, I'm just, for context, for everybody to keep in mind, the covenant. Now, do I think the white person who owns the house, do I think they would be more informed about the covenant? Or do I think the non-white person who is not allowed to be in the neighborhood, George Zimmerman, do I think they would be more informed about the covenant? Mr. Hazzard?
I think that covenant could be there and you could ignore it. I think if you're not allowed to buy a house in a neighborhood, there's no way for you to ignore that.
Would the non-white person have access? Would the non-homeowner, non-white person have access to the covenant?
No, but I think you're aware of, again, I was not alive at that time. I don't know what it was like, but I would imagine that a black family was aware of a neighborhood in which they were not allowed to live.
The white people, would they be aware of that as well?
Sure. But that's also then. I think these are things that also continue to exist today. And I think where it is perhaps a little bit less well drawn, I think people look away from it and tend to ignore it.
Which people?
Oh, white people. I think if you're the beneficiary of something, I think it probably, you know, it becomes easier to make yourself ignorant of it.
But you're not ignorant. You wrote this book. You're informed about racism, white supremacy. You did all this research. Yes?
I don't know. Am I informed? Am I ignorant? I'm sure. I'm sure yes to both of those questions to varying degrees.
I don't understand that at all. So the question, you are informed about racism, white supremacy. You wrote this book, which is directly about racism.
Sure.
Okay. Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. I'm saying I'm as ignorant as anyone else. However, like I'm pausing at calling myself, you know, enlightened in any kind of way.
I didn't say enlightened. I just said that you're informed. That is Woo. Fascinating. Words. I pay attention to words on this program. That fascinating. I have to go back and listen to that myself. It is Thanksgiving, and you did even get the pilgrims in the book. I wanted to ask about this metaphor, which I found fascinating for different reasons. So this is after the demise of Freedom House, which I think everybody knew was just a matter of time in the text. So they kick all the black people to the curb. They send Darnella Wilson off as an 18-year-old girl to the prisons to guard folks and what have you. John Moon and the others, they parcel them out, and then they give them these random, like, pop quiz. We got to do, you know, anatomy tests and see if you know all the procedures. And if you fail, out of the door, get out of here. Doesn't matter how long you worked here, you know, get the road. We've tested you and all the rest of it. So they bunker down. John Moon, again, he organizes study sessions and all the rest. Just, I'm so impressed. Everybody here, Darnella Wilson, there's so many people that are impressive. But, wow, John Moon is amazing. Now, this is chapter 40, the pilgrim metaphor pops up. So you write, one thing was quickly becoming clear. The city might have been forced to take Freedom House employees, but it wasn't forced to keep them. From the very beginning, every move seemed driven by racism and spite. There we go again, spite selling, and aimed at weeding them out. The medics trained to the nation's highest standards were forced to take yet another course administered by the city, which didn't even meet federal requirements, even though they passed a more advanced version of the very same class the city's medics had taken. They were all sent back to school. Nancy was livid and protested, but got nowhere. And so they sat through the lectures covering topics they'd already learned and applied in the field, taught to them by instructors who were openly antagonistic and dismissive. Life was no better on the ambulance. Actually, before I get to, because we have workplace racism all the time, and I mean, Jesus Christ, this is workplace racism. I was telling people when I read this, I said, dang, like, they kicked some of these black people. They fired them, basically. They had years of experience and high-quality training to be replaced with white people who were less competent and had less years of experience. Is that true, Mr. Hazzard? And who were racist?
It's 100% true. It's sad, not shocking perhaps, but 100% true.
Workplace racism. That's why I said we have to talk to John Moon, because I cannot imagine. And he even figured out a code to navigate all of that without being fired or killing everybody. John Moon. Anyway, let's see. Here we go. Continuing from the portion that I just read. So he's with the incompetent white people, blah, blah. Yet whatever overconfidence the city medics exhibited when dealing with John disappeared the moment they rolled into the hill. The hill was a place they knew only from reading the papers or watching TV. They expected crime and murder, utter madness, and they showed up edgy and secretly forgot about that part, and secretly armed with knives, brass knuckles. Are you, come on, wait a minute, pause. For real, nunchucks, who told you this? Nunchucks, are you being hyperbolic, man?
No, I wouldn't make that up. John said that his partner showed up with all sorts of weapons, including knives, brass knuckles, and nunchucks.
I can't believe it. Who goes out? Can you imagine? I mean, Flavor Flav was ahead of his time. My God. You call for, I'm in cardiac arrest. I'm having a heart attack. And they show up. He's got brass knuckles and nunchucks. I'm done. Woo, get my composure. He says, anything to beat back the menace. Jesus Christ. To them, places like the Bedford dwellings weren't residential areas or even housing projects, but war zones that required constant vigilance. A mushrooming sense of unease would set in as they approached. Still en route. Double parking at night. Doesn't matter. Kill the sirens. Flip off the lights. Sneak in. They emerged from the ambulance armed with mag lights, double-checking that the doors were locked. Like pilgrims stepping onto foreign soil, they entered slowly without a word. Quiet on the stairs, or they'll hear you. That is well written, Mr. Hazzard, but wow. The pilgrims? What's up with this metaphor? Are they, with Thanksgiving time, they were pilgrims sneaking in?
I mean, I think they viewed themselves as people who were landing on foreign shores. You know, they had never been to the Hill. They didn't know anybody from the Hill. They knew only what they had seen of it on the news, and what they had seen was not good, and it felt very other. And, you know, they were sort of simultaneously scared and fascinated.
Nunchucks. John Moon is a legend. The just words, I'm backing up. This is in chapter 24. You write, the animosity went beyond the philosophical. This wasn't just a glaring difference of opinion and practice between competing ambulance services in places like the Hill and Oakland. It touched every facet of their lives, and it went way back. Everyone knew the flashpoints. August 1968, two dozen black men attacked Assistant Police Superintendent John Kelly during a heated city council meeting about the use of police tactical squads to break up demonstrations in Homewood. Then, and you go on to list some of the other incidents. Young black male was shot by the police in a case of mistaken identity. We could have been talking about that today. The first one, they attacked John Kelly. What happened here?
Yeah, so that's a city council meeting where they're discussing, you know, there were large groups of young men that were walking around the city, young black men in various neighborhoods, and the way that the police were trying to break them up was something referred to as these tactical squads, which, you know, I don't know if everybody, Atlanta at one point had something called Red Dog, which was a unit that, you know, they were essentially, they kind of came in and swung first, asked questions later, if ever. And these tactical squads are very similar to that. They use very, you know, aggressive means to try to, you know, restore any kind of order. And people could not stand them. People really, you know, rightly hated their existence and thought that they should be done away with. And he was up there justifying their use and talking about why they needed to do this and the threat that, you know, that the people sort of, you know, marchers in the city presented to law and order in the city, and felt that this was the way to handle it. They, you know, people, as has happened at city council meetings, people were, you know, in the gallery. They start, you know, yelling back and forth, and next thing you know, this sort of like altercation takes place in the middle of city council.
Wow, it came to like physical.
Yeah. Wow. He was, people knocked him down. I mean, this was, again, there were a group of police officers that worked for the city that were aggressive enough in arresting and harassing people, that were not suspected of a crime, that it made its way to a federal judge, and that federal judge actually acted. It was the first city to have a consent decree placed upon it. There was an instance in which two men who'd escaped from a penitentiary killed a police officer, and in searching for him, the police were battering down doors, throwing people out into the street, you know, going into apartment buildings for 2 hours at a time to search, and forcing the residents to stand outside in the cold, knocking their doors off the hinges, pulling guys out of cars, beating them up, and then putting them back in their car because, of course, they were just pulled over. They had nothing to do with this shooting of this officer. So people in that city were really at their wit's end. And for someone to come in and say, well, this type of policing is justified, I think was not something that they were willing to listen to.
Wow. That is stunning. have to go look at the end notes so I can read on that. That is, wow. I do remember the Red Dogs in Atlanta, infamous. Like, wow, that's another aspect of racism. Another book. Somebody, maybe you can write that one too. And yes, we'll do some research on that. Before I let you go, there was once The Delectable Negro. I mentioned that book about once, maybe three or four times a week. Super important. Dr. Nancy Caroline. She comes in towards the end, takes over, and, you know, really helps train them. Her Orwellian reign of terror, I think it was, to get their language more accurate so that would serve John Moon and some of the others as they moved along. You included some of the background that she had some, like, turmoil in her personal life. I think she was having an affair with this white fella, and then he ends up committing suicide, drinking ammonia, like, later on. And so she's kind of got some turmoil in her life, and so she's kind of able to throw herself into her work to escape, I'll say, to escape from some of her personal sorrows. And you include, I guess this is some of what she wrote towards the end of all this when Freedom House is shut down. She writes, "Indeed, there was nothing that could have kept me here, meaning in Pittsburgh, had I not found myself suddenly among genuine, warm human beings again. Down in that base station, I discovered an outpost of honesty, camaraderie, generosity of spirit. The Freedom House people kept me alive, or at least kept alive in me some shred of faith, and for that, I owe them." That's from a white woman who comes down, and it's not like she was there for the full 8 years. I found it stunning for so many reasons, and you included that one in the book. This will be my one to wrap up with. Why was that important enough for you to include in the book?
The woman that I talked to, who had been a part of Freedom House, kept coming back to Nancy Caroline. Just her name popped up time and time and time again, and it was always in this. It was in a different way. You know, Peter Saffer is the father of CPR. He's a guy who draws up the paramedic program. He's done all these incredible things, but he's sort of mentioned more as this other thing, you know, this sort of intellectual force. Whereas Nancy is described in very personal terms. She's the first of the physicians. She's the only of the physicians to really make a personal connection with people who are working on the ambulances. And, you know, her personal history is very critical to EMS because she wrote the textbook that was used for decades. She moved to Israel, started their EMS program. She started their hospice program. So she left an indelible mark on the field, but the relationship that resulted from her arriving in Pittsburgh, the relationship that she had with the people there, you know, for her, it was this incredibly important, you know, poignant thing that, you know, helped to define an early part of her life. And I think for the people involved, you know, she arrived at a moment where they were aware that they needed, you know, that they were at a critical juncture. There was somebody who was going to be chosen to be the national standard. They wanted it to be them. You know, she helped them get there, but she did it in a way that they felt she understood them, that they trusted one another. And that was the first time that they had really fostered a connection between any of the physicians that worked with the program.
Fascinating. I have to ponder on that. John Moon, hopefully we behaved, asked good questions, listeners behaved as well. John Moon, I would love to chat it up with him. If I can maybe forward you an email or what have you can pass it along, see if, you know, we would be worthy. He could listen to this and, you know, see if we sound like reasonable folks to chat with for a little while. But, man, it would be grand. Nunchucks, man, for real. Let's tell me about the nun. And then you can tell me about the white woman who thinks that you're about to rape her or what have you, even though she's about to go into cardiac arrest. Like, we would love to chat it up with him and just to give some applause. Like, wow, he has my utmost respect. Even if we can't chat it up with him, you can just let him know, wow, he is absolutely an amazing figure, super inspiring. Everybody at Freedom House, really, but wow, I'm staggered. John Moon, everybody should read the book just to know about John Moon, a legend, and we'd love to chat with him if possible.
The story is his passion. You know, I'm sure that that he would like nothing more than to come on and spend some time talking about it. This is, he's dedicated his life to getting the story out.
Nunchucks, man. Nunchucks. Can you imagine the reverse? Now, black people, you're working. You're going to be an EMT, and you're going to a white neighborhood, and you would rightly be scared. I don't know. I'm going to take brass knuckles in as you're going to work on white brass knuckles and nunchucks as we go to knock on. Come on. Come on. Woo. I learned a ton reading the book. It is disgraceful. I feel like everybody should know about it, especially in Pitt. Like, they should have, like, monuments and plaques. They should bring everybody connected with Freedom House, bring them out to the Steelers game and, I don't know, sing the national anthem or have something. I don't know. But you can read American Sirens, the incredible story of the black men. Probably some black misandry, too, going on here, and then being deliberately forgotten, erased. But the full title, American Sirens, the incredible story of the black men who became America's first paramedics. Pittsburgh history. If you live in Pittsburgh, matter of fact, you have any connection to health medicine, you should read this book. If you live in Pennsylvania, you should own this book immediately. And it's, I don't think it's difficult. He's no footnotes, got end notes. If you have children, they can read it, digest it. Wow, you will learn a lot, and then you'll have things to go research. Thank you so much for being generous with your time and energy, Mr. Hazzard. I will drop you a line so that we can chat it up with Mr. John Moon. I am super impressed and inspired just by hearing about him, and hopefully listeners will be able to read the book, and then we'll be able to hear from him directly. Thank you again for, wow, loved it. Glad you got in some of the great details in the text. I appreciated it.
Yeah, thank you. I really appreciate you having me on.
For sure, for sure. Mr. Kevin Hazzard, author of American Sirens. Thank you so much, sir. Enjoy the rest of your evening.
All right, same to you.
Yes, sir. Context of white supremacy. It is not Turkey Day. It is the Cow's Week every day. This is just one. Mr. Hazzard, starting things off. Man, all the one. We had someone wrote me. I had to go back through my email. I've just been reading and boom, 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 preparing because we have programs tomorrow and then Wednesday. So no free time. Counter racist grind. There was a listener. He emailed me. I think it was earlier this year. And he said, hey, Gus, myself, other folks, we would love more content on health and racism. Super important. I agree. Super important. That's something, you know, we would like to hear, would like to listen to. And I was like, wow, what specifics? Specifics, because I said, man, that is one, like, I used to be, or still am, very tough in terms of content, things we need to cover, topic, subject matter. And I said, for a long time, environmental racism, I mentioned that today. I said, man, that's one we had an F for a long time with. That's super important. That's related to health. That impacts so many black people, non-white people all over the world. And we really hadn't talked about that much at all. We don't have an F anymore. We've, you know, done better. Still learning. Health, we got an A. And that's, I don't need a curve. You can grab any podcast you want. Let's, you know, you can even grab the Harvard podcast, what have you. If they Harvard Health and Sciences, I don't care what you grab. I think we would stack up pretty favorably, particularly if you look at our 13-year history. We've had people, I didn't even say person. We've had people from Harvard Health School come on to talk about health and racism amongst many, many others. And then Dr. Welsing is a medical doctor. She was here 31 times. I mean, Vernelia Ramey, you can go all the way back. In fact, you can go forwards, backwards. Vernelia Randall, Dying While Black. She was with us in 2009. Nurse, she wrote a whole book, Racism and Health, and Suggestions. We talked about smoking with her. Then we had her on the program again. What is that, 11 years later? After the Rona started, to revisit some of those same issues and how it applied to the pandemic. We had Dr. Vanessa Grubbs on the program before the pandemic. And then after the pandemic, we read Medical Apartheid. We read Henrietta Skloot, Rebecca Skloot, The Immortal Life of Henrietta Lacks. That's what I mean. Like, they say stand by your work gladly. With health, we have an A. I don't even think I'd have time. We've had guests on from outside the U.S. to talk about health and racism. So you'd have to tell me specific things with health and racism if you would like more content. You even got another one today. Bang. But that's an area that we have not in any way, shape, form, neglect. I said Alondra Nelson. We talked about this subject matter very close before Body and Soul, Black Panther Party, and their focus on health and racism. Very important. Neely Fuller Jr. said, hey, if I'm controlling all areas of people activity, I have your health. Indeed. We'll take a quick pause, give updates for the programs later on in the week, see if folks have any thoughts before we get ready to wrap things up. And yes, prepare for a full week of counter-racism broadcasting. Hopefully constructive, not wasting time when people could be, you know, doing something. If you have time away from the plantation, perhaps, formal plantation maybe this week, you can do some reading, cleaning, exchanging views in a constructive manner with other family members, so-called, other things other than watching television, perhaps. Quick break, right back. Context of white supremacy.
And from the late 1960s, after the death of Martin Luther King and the riots and the upheavals and all like this, and black people with their fists in there and all like that, and trying to stumble and fumble and find their way and get focus, the white supremacists made a blueprint and put it in action. And that is, I'm going to have these people so confused, they don't even know what they started out to do. And by the late 1970s, they had just about completed it. And we've been on that ever since. And you mentioned something very important. They are more comfortable than ever. Well, see, it's like making gorillas comfortable in a cage, or monkeys, or pandas. You still got them in a cage, but they're comfortable. See, so give him some bling bling. It's like giving an animal a brand new car and training the animal to ride up and down the street in it. And then you stand back and point at the animal. Like one white man said in the late 1950s, he said he doesn't care what kind of car a Negro has. He said he's still a nigger. And when he rides by in a shiny car, to him, it's just a monkey in a car. White people built a car, put a monkey in it, trained the monkey to drive the car, so now you're looking at a monkey in a car. See, but black people don't see themselves that way. But this is how the white supremacists see us, and they are the ones who run our business. And we have to know that, that when they look at us, that's what they see. That's what they see. And at a subliminal level, what they see begins to spill over into our brains so that we, at a subliminal level, see each other that way. And indirectly see ourselves that way.
Neely Fuller Jr., producejustice.com. It is not Turkey Day. It is the Cow's Week. Every day, hopefully constructive. Be here tomorrow, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. Be here Wednesday. We will not be at the normal time because we'll have a guest on who is not in the States. Workplace racism. I love it. Love it. But that'll be Wednesday. And then we'll be back to normal book club on Wednesday, wrapping up Bill Russell, The Great Second Wind, and then Neutralizing Workplace Racism Proper on Friday, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. And again, compensatory call in normal time with everything else, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. So 8 p.m. every day except Wednesday. That day we will be early. 3 p.m. Eastern. Oh, 2 p.m. Sorry. 2 p.m. Eastern. 11 p.m. 11 a.m. See those morning shows? Like, oh, hate them, but time zone, nothing you can do about that. 2 p.m. Eastern, 11 a.m. Pacific on Wednesday. Guest not in the States. Looking forward, workplace racism. Workplace racism. Oh, love it, love it, love it, love it, love it. We'll have authors on every day. Reading is more important than watching television. Hopefully, someone asked me not too long ago about, they said, do you only have authors as guests on the program? I said, no. You know, we've had lots of people who've, filmmakers. We talked about folks who've done documentaries and what have you, and activists, people who've done none of the above, have been guests on the program. So no, but reading is more important than watching television. Mr. Fuller, Dr. Welsing, Dr. Kanban, most of the folks that we talk about, Minister Malcolm X, they regularly encourage that we go out and read, try to study, learn something about everything, help solve this problem. So I do try to, you know, encourage, promote that by having authors on. And particularly since there are authors, so many white authors who write about white supremacy racism, hey, now we have an opportunity. We can ask questions about racism, what they wrote, use logic and interrogate. Great illustration today. I don't think this is one of my, you know, favorite books or anything, but even with that, I learned quite a bit. Number one, John Moon, Darnella Wilson, George McCary. He has the whole list of these black people, most of them black males, who worked at the Freedom House. This first, really, paramedics unit in the U.S. Go out and help black people in the Hill, black people in Pittsburgh, who they didn't even want to serve. We didn't even want to, you know, do any ambulance or what have you. They talk about how the police would go and grab somebody and they're sloshing around, flying around in the back. Nobody's trained on anything. I mean, so that's one, just to learn about these individuals. Hopefully we can talk to Mr. Moon directly, learn about some of these folks. And because there's such a long history. Emmy talked about that. She's in med school right now. There is such a long deliberate history of individuals classified as white, prohibiting, restricting, denying black people access to health care and knowledge so that they can go out and be healers, doctors, midwives, lactation counselors, whatever it is, denying black people CPR specialists, so you can be trained and all that, denying them the opportunity to have these jobs, to have this learning, to heal themselves. That, I mean, or to heal themselves and others. That is hugely important. Continues right now. They sit around and talk about how we don't have any black doctors here in the States and elsewhere in the world. Deliberate. Especially black males. Especially black male doctors, just like teachers. With this book, other things that I learned, that portion, and that might even sound clip, there would be two that I think might be sound clip, that exchange about the culture, white defiance, the portion in the book that he has about cholera, white people in Europe, some Indian disease, and them drifting off into conspiracy theories, rioting, we're not gonna, you know, observe these rules. Oh my, I highlighted that, I shared that as soon as I read that from this text, that things like that are important. Oh, this is a component of white culture. I asked him about that directly. Am I misreading this? I'm still learning. Maybe I didn't get it right. He said, nope, you're reading painfully, you read it correctly. Doing the exact same thing now, 200 years later, other side of the world, doing the exact same. I mean, the racist motivation and all of it. This is some nigger disease. You're not going to make me wear a mask. You got these, you know, conspiracies, and you all trying to do this in 5G. For real. This is why, this is how you all behave. Now, that's the sort of thing I would have to think about. When I hear people saying, the Rona ain't real, like, uh-oh. That is white culture. You all have a history. Pandemics. Serious problems. Serious health threats. Not taking it seriously. This is a conspiracy. And particularly, if there's some, this is some Negro disease. This is the colored people. Oh. If I had known more details about that, I would have been saying when all of this started, take this seriously, not because I'm a doctor, not because I'm informed, but because it seems that's a part of white culture. Health threat, pandemic comes, conspiracy, razor, we're not going to do it. Not taking it seriously. We're not going to follow the protocols. That's a part of white culture, a dangerous component of white culture. I'm not going to follow that. That was one thing thought was very important, worthy of a sound clip. Then the exchange about who is more informed about racism. Loved it. Loved it. Loved it. Because we started out, non-white people are more informed. We even switched the terms up right there. Asked what racism is, how it works. We switched that up. We went. He went to hatred and all that. Like, what? Whoa. What? Wait a minute. Let's go back to the question. He says, well, now I think white people are informed. And I said, well, who do you think is more informed about the covenant? That's exactly what you just said. Spite selling, right in the book and everything, right? Who's more informed about the covenant? You're telling me that the homeowner, they're not informed about their own covenant, or the person who doesn't own the house and may be beaten for even going to the neighborhood, they are more informed about this covenant than the white person. How would that be? Who wrote the covenant? All of that, just for listeners, even as I've had time to think on it, at least for me, when we did not have Dr. Kevorkian, we had Dr. Kevorkian since 2016, and then we picked up Dr. Heather Brown this month. So now we have two white people who have said white people are more informed. I think having piles, and I mean hundreds and hundreds of white people unanimously, non-white people are more informed. And particularly when it gets absurd, when you had, because he was resistant to admit, I'm informed. You wrote a whole book about racism. What's the title of this thing again? American Sirens, the incredible story of the black men who became America's first paramedics. It's all about racism. That right there, because it's my experience, white people are generally not sheepish about their expertise. It's only white supremacy, race. Whoa. I am not an expert at all. Did you write this whole book and research it? Years of work, you go around and do these. Yeah, that might be true. And this book is about racism. That might be true. But I mean, you know, I'm still learning. Like, what? That's just I could be totally wrong, but I think. But say you have to. I think you would have to hear a few of them, maybe, or maybe even rewind some of them, maybe both. But I think that should stick out. The absence of logic, all of it. In fact, I prefer that they say non-white people, so that we can just ask more questions. More questions. If they're going to be logical and honest, that's great. They can give us the logic of why it is that. Yeah, I guess the white people who put that covenant, no niggers, spite selling, I guess you can't really be ignorant about racism. And then not to mention all this of deliberately doing away with freedom. I guess he even has some of the racist jokes in here from the construction site and all the rest of it. If all that's the case, then I mean, yeah, that's... Yeah. Anywho, we'll be here tomorrow, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. White guests. We'll see if folks have thoughts. Invest if you think the program is constructive, listener-supported, counter-racist radio. The blog is racism-notes.blogspot.com. PayPal button is in the top right corner. You'll see the links Cash App, PayPal, Venmo. Hopefully, we have been worthy of your time and energy almost 14 years. Quite a bit of focus on health and white supremacy racism over that time period. Let us see. Folks who dialed in, if y'all have thoughts, observations to share. Let's see. Retired firefighter, our caller at 2262. If y'all had any thoughts to share before we wrap up, or any of the other folks, what you heard from Mr. Hazzard, proceed.
Yes, sir. Prior to you mentioning about the black males in Pittsburgh, I think a couple of weeks ago, I didn't know anything about it. Charles Phillips knew about it. Probably, being that what I know about him, he probably knew about it. You know, the chief that was on your program years ago, but I didn't know anything. I didn't know anything about him at all. I'm kind of not surprised because, from the standpoint of when it comes to things like white people don't want to be touching our bodies, not in that way. Sexually, yes, but not in that way, and also in terms of death, that they basically avoid that type of contact. So I can see where that came about. Also, from the standpoint of when the military was separated white people from non-white people, the few units, black, all black units who that did combat in World War II, I figured that one of the soldiers had to be a corpsman. That in World War II, as well as in the Korean War, and of course, you know, they had to be that way to have a corpsman within the, whatever size of the group of soldiers. And I think that person took those skills, the survivors anyway, took those skills into more of things of the areas where black people were allowed to stay at. Yes, black people had a high level of admiration when we would show up on calls and the rescue unit as well as the fire truck would be all black. We actually planned that process on the job that I was on with myself and Mr. Clark and a few other guys, once we had the seniority, and in the area in Miami Gardens, which, you know, is a large, numbers of non-white black people, as well as the area just south of Miami Gardens called Opa-locka, it's high levels of black people. And, we managed to maintain it for about maybe a year, something like that. Whereas, because nobody else wanted to work with us anyway, once we got those positions. So it ended up being all black. And matter of fact, some black people didn't want to work with us. So basically we had the people who worked with us basically had the admiration, I guess you want to call it, because they knew we were doing things when we weren't on duty. As far as trying to end the system of racism, white supremacy, counter racist activities we were doing when we weren't on duty. Yeah, but like I said before, it's a very, when it comes to doing that type of work on fire departments, especially most of them are very large fire departments that has paramedics, as opposed to calling a private service. It's a county or city service, and very lucrative. And the retirement in almost all of those places that I know of is very, very good. You have me as an example as far as that concern. That's why they make it, quite difficult for a black person, especially a black male. And also you don't have to go to college to do it, you know, to run up a tuition fee to whereas you would be paying for something. You could get that training as soon as you come out of high school. Matter of fact, you can get it before you leave high school. You can start in on it. And they'd be having their sons, nephews, daughters. We're talking about white people, including white people who speak Spanish down here that are involved with that. Whereas we are limited to that process. And those are just some of the things that I was thinking about.
Retired firefighter in Florida, rebellious Negro. I'm glad to get that perspective included, because that's exactly what they talked about in the book, when it's been hostile, racist man generally showing up for an emergency situation for like ever, and then all of a sudden it's, whoa, black brother. And they're trained, like, not just, you know, showing up and bumbling idiot and all that, then they'd probably get cursed out too. But I mean, whoa, black brother, and they know what they're doing. Like, dang, they know how to use the hose, and dang, like, he got his uniform, and man, black, like, I mean, for that time period, like, when that would probably be similar to the way we have seen black people behave to, like, President Obama and Wes Moore in Maryland. Like, oh my God, like, what it's been forever, and now, and they're competent. Like, whoa, it's not just, you know, retired fire actually knows what to do. He is a trained firefighter. He got the CPR and everything. Dang, got the ladder and driving. Whoa, man. Like, that, that's why I said we got to talk to John Moon. Like, mandatory. We got to. And the nunchucks, they said they got the number. Anyway, but all of that, like, I am sure it had to be a stunning moment for, like, President Obama, Wes Moore. Same thing that we have, you know, unfortunately, still seeing at this late date, 2025 almost. Let's see.
Yes.
Caller at 2262, did you have commentary? Or you're just driving, hopefully driving safely, or maybe you arrived by now.
Yes, sir. I just wanted to know about all the laughter when you ask them certain questions. I don't assume that that's some kind of nervous tick. I assume that he possibly knows more than what he's letting on to for us to believe. That's just one point that out. But thank you for taking my call.
Much obliged, good sir. No, one of the point out of many, I know I pointed out a few, when he said that people do not, if they're in an emergency situation where they need assistance, medical assistance, that they, you know, are not concerned about the person that shows up to help. That's like, come on now. Come on now. I don't know if that's talking to me like I didn't read the book, or if that's just they generally, individuals who are classified as white, I can say whatever I want to, talking to niggers, and, you know, who are they to challenge or question me? It's like, man, Oh, man. I already had that part highlighted. I was going to save that and read a little bit later, but whew, I can read it right now. Like, you got a really chunky anecdote. And like I said, I'm sure that's not the only one. If he went into that great of detail about that one time George McCary, John Moon go in and the wife, oh my God, these drug peddling, raping niggas, you get your hands off my chest. Ma'am, you might get your hands off my chest. There's nobody here. Like, I mean, you're going to die. Like, make a decision. We can leave and you can die, or we can help you. She's like, die, rape, ooh, rock in a hard place. That's what I'm saying. I'm between the fire and the frying pan. Like, oh, look, that right there. Now, that's, forgive my laughter, that right there tells you a whole lot about what it means to be white, because there are many, many, many examples of that, where it was a white person who needed emergency critical service. Mr. Fuller said it was a group of white people. They were on a ship. Uh-oh, accident. We might be sinking. Matter of fact, we are going to sink. We got to evacuate. Men, women, women and children, you know, get out of here. Let's get the life jackets on and all that. And he said they allowed some non-white people to go first. They touched the rope. The white people, look at this. Ugh. I'm not touching it. You let them niggers touch it. They stayed on the ship and died. I just read a report earlier this year. They had a white man. They were talking about doing a blood transfusion. And they let him know the blood was coming from a black person. He said, no. That's what it's going to be then, you know. Hey, it has been a good run. Fare thee well, everybody. Let me get my affair. Whoa. We could save it. If it's got to come from a nigger, I don't need to be saved. Thank you all kindly. Let me get my affairs in order. God bless. And checked on out. Serious about it now. I mean, hey, we got all the organ theft and all of that, so not every racist thinks that way. But I mean, that tells me a lot about what it means to be white. Why use that word dedication? I know a whole lot of black people who've had bad experiences with racism, white supremacy. Whew. I know tons of them who really would not think twice about going to a white doctor, white teacher, sending their white child to, sending their non-white child to a white teacher, white doctor. Some of us do it every day. Individuals classified as white, apparently, they don't think that way at all. Probably why we don't have very many black doctors. Matter of fact, they got that doctor in North Carolina. I played it all that time. He said he would have white patients all the time come in. Old Negro physician. Being uppity, man. Like all of that. This is like 21st century. What does it mean to be white? Anywho, anything else folks need to get in?
Yes, I can concur on the experience of white people turning down a black person dealing with them in emergency situations. Golf course that was in the area that lasted longer than white people residing in the area. We went on a call there, and basically the white people were complaining and complaining about us, and was nothing but black people on the both units. And some of us decided to just, okay, well, if you didn't want my treatment, then I'm gonna sit back on the truck. And Mr. Clark can tell you plenty of stories, because he actually rode on a rescue truck for most of his career. So he could tell you of plenty of situations where that took place, where a white female wife would tell him that I don't want you touching my husband. So that is that was that I don't know about now or anything like that, but that was common. That was common.
According to Mr. McDuff in North Carolina, it is unfortunately still common white patients to say that sort of thing in a medical environment where they do actually need assistance and there is a non-white person qualified to offer assistance, maybe even save a life. White doctor, please. That. What does it mean to be white? We should all think about that one. Again, we will be here tomorrow and the next day and the next day, white people permitting. White guest again tomorrow. Loving it. Bill Russell, book club Thursday, Second Wind will be here. You can, I don't know, maybe you can have your giblets and what have you while listening. It should be short because we'll be wrapping up the book this week. The hair component, I'm so glad I was able to ask him about that because that was fascinating as well. Retired firefighter got in trouble about that lip beard, but that was fascinating as well. And that is in flipping Bill Russell's memoir about the, they're about to make a rule. You got these niggers wearing beards around. Put that in the rule book. No double dribble, no nigger beards. Put that in the rule book, right? Like, wow. Amazing. And that's why I said when they do all this talk about the Crown Act and the many decades of white terrorism that black females have experienced in the workplace because of their hair, very true. Just include black males. Bill Russell. Wilt Cham just got a little peach fuzz on my chin and they got to put new rules. Like, come on. Come on. John Moon. Cannot wait to see if we can get him on the program. Hear about the nunchucks, white nunchuck wielding EMT. I can't even imagine. I asked for someone, I'm having a heart attack, and I got a white man with nunchucks coming in the house. And brass knuckles and nunchucks. Like, come on. Come on. Man. And we got Charles Manson in too. Of course. We'll be here tomorrow, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. White guests only. Sobriety would be best. I guess we didn't hear because I didn't read those portions, but there's a lot of that in this book. And firefighter can probably attest to that. Anybody else who's worked that line of work, a lot of these calls are for people who are under the influence. Drugs, liquor, whatever it is, and however that's manifested, car accident, stumbled, fell out in public, whatever the case may be, that is a lot of these calls. And having to go out and do all of that. I think they start the book with one of those and go through and trying to figure, oh, okay, this person, he's had one, two, oh, I see the tequila in his pocket. Sobriety would be best under conditions of white supremacy racism, where the EMT showing up, if you do drink a little too much or get too much narcotics or the wrong narcotics or however else it works out poorly, EMT shows up with brass knuckles and nunchucks. Creator, we ask that you help us remain patient with other black people victims of white supremacy. We ask that you help us remain patient with ourselves. Remind us to demonstrate the highest levels of black self-respect at all times, in all places, each and every time we are in contact with another black person. It has been time. Replace white supremacy with justice. Immediately. No name calling, no gossip. We heard that gossiping Negroes, peddling drugs in the ambulance. Heard it from the mayor. That right there, no gossiping, no throwaway offspring. Cow signing out. Thanks all for tuning in.
Nigga, you so brainwashed.
I'm a victim, brother.
No problem. You're a victim.
Man, I'm a victim of 400 years of conditioning.
Shut up.
The man has programmed my conditioning. Even my conditioning has been conditioned.